Love you.
Praise God.
Come on, clap your hands unto God.
Hallelujah.
Shout unto God with the voice of triumph. Amen. Corinthians 1:31. We glory in you and you alone. You said in Psalms 18:3, I will call upon the Lord who's worthy to be praised, and so shall I be saved from my enemies. You are worthy to be praised. Worthy are you, Lord. Hallelujah. We declare you're worthy, and while we're saying you're worthy, God, you said we'd win against our enemies. Somebody say, give him thanks for victory. Amen. Through Jesus. Somebody say, that's the key. Through Jesus. Praise God. Victory over devils. Victory over sin. Victory over bondage. Victory, come on somebody, over every disease, every sickness, every illness. Victory. Hallelujah. If you're a victim, just stay quiet. If you're a victor, come on. You ought to let your mouth sound like victory. Vocabulary, God can put it in you. He can make it, amen, come alive in you, for you. Come on, somebody. That's why the word trumpet or triumph, the voice of triumph in Psalms 47:1 that God said he wants his people to shout with, amen, was a sound of victory. Triumph. Triumph means victory, but triumph comes from the word trumpet. Hit it one more time. Hallelujah. Descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God. Dead in Christ going to rise first, then we that are alive and remain shall be called there with the Lord in the clouds, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. 1 Thessalonians 4:16-17. When he comes back, you're going to hear the sound of the trumpet. Come on, somebody. Having somebody say a sound of praise. A trumpet where it's not only just a sound of praise, but it was also a sound of war. They would blow the trumpet, the shofar. God would tell his people, make that sound, that victory sound, before the battle ever begins. Go ahead and sound like the battle's already over. Go ahead and make a sound, a noise. Somebody say a noise. A noise of victory. Glory to God. Hallelujah. This fight's fixed. And the Bible said in Numbers 10:9, he said, when you blow your trumpet and I hear it, God says, I'll move among your enemy. Come on, somebody. And I'll defeat them for you. Somebody shout, that's a deal right there. God said, if you'll praise me with a sound of triumph, the voice of triumph and victory, God said, I'll just go right before you and I'll go ahead and do all the fighting for you. You just come along and reap all the benefits of the spoil of it. Come on, somebody. God said, when I hear them blow that trumpet, he said, in their land, when the enemy comes against them in their land, God said, I'll go before them and defeat their enemies. That's Numbers 10, verses 9. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for victory. Amen. I want to sing an old song. Praise God. Probably going to have to adjust the volume on a little bit because I took it from a cassette years ago and threw it onto a CD and then ripped it in the computer and now it's in that computer. So it's probably lost something along the way, I'm sure. Praise God. Amen. So you may have to tweak some of the highs. Probably it's probably going to be a little low. But this old song says, oh, what a reason. Amen. Hallelujah. Jesus said in John 14, verse 17, because I live, you shall live also. Yes. Somebody say, you can't hang out with Jesus. And not experience life. The light of life. Fullness of life. You walk with him, you won't want to kill yourself. Come on, somebody. You don't want to live. Because his loving kindness is better than life. Therefore will my lips praise him. Psalm 63, verses 3. Somebody say, he's better than life.
For
his neighbor's sake, because sometimes life is a little hard. But if he's your focus in living, even when living gets hard, you can still praise. You can still raise up a thank you, Lord. Glory to God. Because he's worth living for. Amen. Praise God. Amen. You can go ahead. Praise God. Usually when I tell y'all go ahead and play it, I'll preach and talk until I hear music. So if you want me to shut up and sing, just start playing. It's got a lot of low ends in it. Turn my microphone up and the monitors if nowhere else. I've been blessed with so many things. God's been so good to me. I have family and friends who share in all I do. But if I lose it all, I am left with nothing. Oh, if I have the Lord, I know I'll make it through. He's the only reason I live. Oh, what a reason. He's the only reason I live. Oh, what a reason. next one, and that'll be all I'm going to sing for right now. Praise God. Give me some microphone. Not music, microphone. Thank you, Jesus. Worthy are you, Father. You're the only one never lets me down. You've always been my tower of strength. The promises you make are everlasting vows, and I'm always overshadowed with your blessings. Lord, you've always been faithful to me.
Faithful one.
praise you, Jesus. As for God, his way is perfect. Psalms 18:30. Somebody say, everything he does, everything he says, is perfect. He's never made a mistake. He didn't make a mistake in allowing you to be born. Come on, somebody. You might not even know who your biological parents are, but you are no mistake. Can you imagine that? Never messes up. Only him. That's why the blood he shed on that Roman rugged cruel cross has power to forgive and cleanse sin. Because it was perfect blood, not tainted like ours, but sin. Somebody say perfect. David said in Psalms 119 verse 96, he said, I have beheld the end of perfection. He said, but your commandments are exceedingly broad. In other words, David searched out and he said, I thought I found the end of perfection. I thought, man, it can't get no better than this. And then I looked in your word. Woo! Because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, John 1:1. When he looked into the Word, he realized the Word was a person. Somebody say, a perfect person.
Perfect person.
There's no flaws. Come on, somebody, in thus saith the Word of God that's written. Hallelujah. He said in John 17:17, sanctify them with thy truth. Thy word is truth. If you're looking for truth, absolute truth, come on somebody, is the word of God, because Revelation 19:13 said he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name, somebody say Jesus, his name is called the word of God. The word of God is a perfect, somebody say a perfect person.
Perfect.
Jesus never lied.
Amen.
Hello?
Amen.
He didn't have a girlfriend called Mary Magdalene. Come on, somebody. See, the world has to make him a sinner. Come on, somebody. To try to tear down everything he stands for. Because if they can find somewhere he sinned, well, then surely they can say, oh, this is a hoax, that message of the cross, and he weren't really God. But friend, the blood Jesus shed was without spot. Come on, somebody. God said in 1 Peter 1:18, talks about his blood. Come on, somebody. Is without spot or blemish. Lamb of God. Come on, somebody. Somebody say, the perfect Lamb of God. No blemish, no spot. Praise God. Hallelujah. He's the one, the only one who walked this earth in perfection. Holy. Never sinned. The Bible teaches us clearly he knew no sin. But he took our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead unto sin shall live unto righteousness, by whose stripes we were healed. 1 Peter 2:24. Somebody shout, he knew no sin, but he took our sin. Praise God. He was punished for our sin. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. Come on, somebody. And with his stripes we are healed. Isaiah 53:5. Praise God. Somebody shout, he was punished for my sins, so I might have peace with God. You can't have peace, the peace of God, without first making peace with God. And Colossians 1:20 said, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Somebody shout, through the blood of Jesus. There's peace with God, which results in the peace of God. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Only his precious, perfect blood. Somebody shout, the blood of Jesus is perfect. God never makes a mistake. Titus 1:2, he said, I'm the God that cannot lie. He's never lying. Come on, somebody. The grass withereth, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Isaiah 40:8. Throughout history, come on, somebody. Dictators, rulers, amen, full of devils, have sought to try to take this Bible. They thought they could do away with it if they could burn it. They thought they could stop it if they persecuted its believers. Come on, somebody. But in doing so, you find out through Scripture, every time demons manifest to try to take away the Word of God, when the religious crowds told the apostles, you can't talk no more in this name. The Bible always talks about, like God's Word in Acts 19:21 said, so mightily grew the Word and prevailed.
Praise God.
Every time this Word was persecuted, it grew. In Exodus 1:12, it talked about the Hebrew children. The more, listen to this, they were afflicted, the more they grew and multiplied. Every time the wicked one comes against God's chosen, come on somebody, and tries to stop the people of this book. This book, come on somebody, reaches more people. Somebody shout, you can't stop it. You can't stop him. They tried to. They thought they did, but they drove the spikes through his wrist and through his feet. Come on, somebody. But what, he didn't purchase his tomb. He just borrowed it, because 3 days later, he come up behind the grave. Somebody shouts, you can't stop it. You can't stop faith in him.
Praise
God. Look at your neighbor and say, is that your daddy he's talking about? Why are you so quiet? Praise God. Praise the Lord. That's that what we're talking about. Come on, somebody. He can't be stopped. And if you follow him, neither can you. In this world, you're going to have tribulation. He said, but be of good cheer, overcome the world. John 16 and 33. Jesus said, amen, glory to God, if you follow me, you'll overcome everything this world throws at you do. Come on, somebody. And he was speaking about the cross. That's how Jesus overcame it. Come on, somebody. Praise God. Somebody shout, the perfect one. Never makes a mistake. You're no accident. Praise God. And Acts chapter 12, verse 24, it said again, the word of God multiplying grew. That was after a heathen king, Herod, stood up and presented himself as God. And God says, I've had enough of you, and struck him dead. Come on, somebody, and the worms eat him. Hello? And God's word was glorified and magnified. It grew. Praise God. Amen. So anytime somebody tries to stand up and say, like our Supreme Court, we're God and we're going to redefine marriage. Come on, somebody. God says, go ahead and do what you want to. You ain't going to stop my word. You may think you're changing it, but I'll just multiply. Look at your neighbors and say, we're going to take over.
Hallelujah.
We're going to inherit the earth. You can behead all the Christians you want to. But when we stand before him, we're going to have a new one, and he's going to put a crown on it, and then we're going to take the crown off, throw it down at his feet, and we're going to rule and reign with him on this earth forever. The meek shall inherit the earth. Bless
them.
Praise God. Look at your neighbor. Say, when it's all said and done and it's over with, Christianity shall take over the earth. You hear about all these people talking about, well, Christianity is on, you know, it's on the downward, and this religion's on the this and the, momentarily maybe, I don't know, you go on. But somebody shout, we take it over.
We take it over.
Because our daddy owns it all. He said, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, Psalms 24, verses 1.
Yes.
Praise God. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm going to own everything on the earth.
I'm on everything on the earth.
One day.
Praise God.
The most expensive real estate you can think about right now is going to be yours. Because he owns it all. Haggai 2 and 8, he said, all the silver and gold is mine. That's the golden rule. He that owns the gold makes all the rules. Come on, somebody. Somebody shout, one day it'll be all ours. You realize the place where you're going to live, the streets is made out of gold. The very thing is that people, come on, somebody, mortgage their house to get so they can wear on their ear or their finger. Come on, somebody. Amen. Up there where we're going, and up there where we're going is coming back down here, because he's bringing it, according to Revelation 21, he's bringing heaven to earth. And his prayer is going to be answered that he prayed in Matthew chapter 6. Come on, somebody. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Somebody shout, it's coming. Somebody say, heaven to earth. Before that, he's going to clean the earth up. According to 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 10, there's going to be a great sound. Amen. A great noise. And the earth and all of its works are going to be burned up. Talk about global warming. There it is for you, Pope.
Yeah.
You know, you want to try that global warming message? Come on, somebody, at the White House. He destroyed the earth one time with a flood, but the next time will be with fire. He's going to purge it. Come on, anybody breathe. Ephesians 3:21 or 22 said, this earth is without end. You hear people talking about the end of the world. Ain't no such thing. The word world means cosmos, means the arrangements of the world. The world as we know it, yeah, is going to come to an end, but the earth ain't going to end. It's a world without end. Come on, it's in your Bible, Ephesians 3:21. Somebody shout, there's no such thing as the end of the world. The end of the earth. there's an end of the age. There's an end of the way things are going and arranged. Yes, that's going to come to a closure. And God says, after I've raptured my church, come on somebody, I'm going to destroy my enemies. Come on somebody, in this earth, all those that oppose my word, all those that were against Israel, come on, anybody hear the Holy Ghost? Yeah. With one word from my mouth, I'm going to smite them in judgment, and I'm going to clean the earth. I'm going to purge it with a fire.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then we get to come back. On white stallions. You can maybe say, if you ain't never rode a horse, you're going to get to it. Praise God.
Brother, that's a little bit out there.
I know, that's where I'm going to be. Thank you. What you got going for you? Huh? Praise God. Pill popping, line snorting. Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
Going to the doctor to get you a fix so you can get high because you can escape what's going on in life and have to bite your nails off watching Fox News and CNN. Oh, God. Look what's coming on the earth. How's that working for you? You want to try what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Somebody the other day said, oh, what are we going to do about ISIS? I said, is. I said, I don't know about is, but I know about I am that I am. I got my faith in I am that I am. That's the way I pronounce it, is. Come on, somebody. Ain't no match for I am that I am. I dreamed about that in the early 90s. I was going into house after house after house at one time, and I was thinking then, how in the world am I going to do that? But since we're in a day of social media, and come on, somebody. There are ways. It makes sense now. Amen. I was going in the house and I was quoting John 14 and 6. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come into the Father but by him. But before I would quote that scripture, I'd tell people as I'd walk in these houses, and I saw people of all nationalities, all different colors of skin. And I remember seeing Middle Eastern people in this dream. And this was in the early 90s. This is like 93 or 94. I'm dreaming this. Amen. And because I got saved in October of 91. And here I am dreaming this. And I'm telling these people going into their house, and it's dark in the streets, real dark. Amen. And I'm telling them in their house, and my message is, Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. And I tell people that everywhere I go still to this day. I'll drive up to a window. I did just Friday night twice. Twice in one night, I had to stop at fast food restaurants. Lord help me, Jesus. But anyhow, I just come off of fast, so I had an excuse. Come on, man. Praise God. At least I thought I did, anyhow. Praise God. Amen. And so I went from one fast to another fast. But anyhow, here, I pull up and while we're making the exchange and they got my food handed to me and I'm giving them their money. Amen. I'm holding on to my money. Amen. And I don't let it go. And I look at them while they're trying to get the money and I said, you heard the good news today? And they always. Because all you hear is bad news every week. Good news, what is it? I said, Jesus loves you. Some of them get under conviction. Others kind of, like Sarah, laugh to keep from crying. One lady, I saw the tears come up in her eyes. Come on, somebody. But in this dream in 93 and 94, I had, amen, I was telling people, Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. I was going in and out of houses at one time, telling them, and oh, they were clapping, they were applauding. I told a witch that in underground Atlanta years ago in the middle 90s. Amen, I was sitting there and prayed an hour and a half before I walked up to her table, amen, where she was, so to speak, reading people's poems. Come on, in her little tea leaves and the cup, and come on, her tarot cards. And when I walked up to her, Brother Young, I told her, I said, ma'am, Jesus loves you. Oh, she applauded that. She shook my hand. Thank you, sir. I believe that. I said, but the same Jesus that loves you also warns you and tells you that you're doing. I went to quoting scriptures against witchcraft and how it's going to those who practice such practices. Revelation 21:8, for example, sorcerers will spin in a lake of fire. Oh, my God, her eyes got beady. Her countenance changed, and the demons that were in her rose up. She began to scream out and holler, please come running, and I had to go. Come on, somebody. Please escort me. But needless to say, that young couple that was about to sit down and get their so-called palm read, they left. I thought, well, Lord, for nothing else, he got them out of there. Praise God. But they were okay with Jesus loves you, even in this dream. I had, oh, everybody like Jesus loves you. Oh, they love that. But in the dream, I said, but Jesus said in John 14 and 6, he said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can come unto God the Father except through him. Their countenance changed in this dream. They picked up machetes. They picked up guns. They picked up all kind of weapons and went to chasing me. In the dream, and the Holy Ghost spoke to me. He said, the day will come, in this nation. This was in 93 and 94. He said, when you preach that simple message, I am the only way. Come on, somebody. Well, brother, that offends me. Well, you just have to get offended and straighten your halo up on your horn. Jesus said it. Come on, somebody. He said, there's no other way to God the Father. Buddha ain't the way. Allah ain't the way. Come on, somebody. Your church denomination ain't the way. Your good works ain't the way. Somebody shout, it's very easy. There ain't but one way to get saved. There ain't but one way to get to heaven. It's through Jesus the Christ, the one that was crucified. Yes. Come on, somebody. On that Roman rugged, cruel cross, he was more than a prophet. If you accept him as a prophet, well, then you got to believe everything he prophesied, even about himself. And he said, I am the one. Glory to God. And you ain't getting to the Father except by me. You don't know Jehovah if you hadn't come through Jesus. You may say you witness about him, but until you've met the Son, you don't know the Father. Because he that hath not the Son has not life. Come on, somebody. 1 John 5, verses 12. I began to preach that message in that dream, and their countenance became demonic. Hello, and they were seeking to try to kill me. In the apostles' days in the book of Acts, same thing. When they preached this Jesus, they were okay with them preaching, but when they declared Jesus, he's it. He's the Messiah.
My Lord.
He's God manifest in the flesh. They wanted to kill him. Many of them did become martyrs. Jesus preached it, and he got him crucified. Thank God, or we'd have never been saved.
Amen.
He raised himself back from the dead, though. Come on to prove it. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. So we're living in dangerous days. We're living in times of terror. Praise God. But it's no time to be ostracized with your head in the sand. Amen. Or your eyes glued to the 6 o'clock news. Come on. Some of us is addicted. Amen. Scared to death. What's going to happen next? Well, you got to watch that to know. It's already been told to us. Come on, somebody. God said in 2 Timothy 3 and verses 12, he said, they that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Yeah. Verse 13, he said, evil men shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived.
Yeah. Amen.
Somebody say, worse and worse.
Worse.
But even in the book of Acts, when you see it getting worse and worse, you see God's power getting stronger and stronger.
Yeah.
2 Timothy 3 talks about how men in the last days, because of perilous times, times of trouble, fearful times, will become lovers of them own selves.
Yeah.
Somebody say, lovers of them own selves. Perilous times are nothing but a direct result of men loving themselves more than God. Loving pleasures more than God. That's why we see the day we're in. And you got to understand something. That Jesus, amen, speaking, amen, through the Apostle Paul to Timothy, is saying, amen, to Timothy's day, all these sinful actions of men, he names in one of those, by the way, verses 3 of 2 Timothy 3, he said they'd be unthankful and unholy. Somebody shout, unholy.
Unholy.
Means you're unthankful. You're no more like the devil when you're complaining. Come on, somebody. Unthankful and unholy. Romans 1, 21 says, even when they knew God, listen to this, they did not acknowledge him as God and were unthankful. And become, glory to God, in their minds darkened with their evil imaginations. And that's where we find them in verse 25, trying to change the truth of God into a lie and worship and serve the creature rather than the Creator, which is blessed forever and all. Amen. Then verse 26, saying they're women leaving. Come on, somebody. That the natural use, and that's against nature. Verse 27, and men likewise with men. Come on, somebody. Burning in their lust one for another, doing that which is unseemly, receiving even the recompense of the reward, amen, which was just or meet. And we find, amen, how people have got so far away from God when they knew him as God, they did not acknowledge him as God. Somebody shouting, they were unthankful to him. They didn't thank him as God. They thanked themselves. They looked to themselves. And so they try to change his word into something it's not. And in doing so, women, amen, start kissing other women in the face. Come on. And now they're saying they can get married. And men, likewise with men, doing the same thing. Come on, somebody. So all that we see, as far as the evil time, tide, amen, that's coming on the seashore, amen, in the banks of this nation is nothing more than years after year after year of men loving themselves more than they love God. Paul told Timothy, he said, they're going to persecute you if you believe what I've said. Evil men, they're going to get worse and worse. Even in 2 Timothy 3, he talks about that these men would be fierce. Come on, somebody. People that don't even have emotions. They're so darkened with demonic activity. They show no remorse over the sinful deeds that they do. Come on. He said it's going to get that bad. Sin's going to become so gross. The darkness thereof is going to be like gross darkness. So dark, darker than it's ever been. Amen. But God says, I want you to know in this time and in this hour, just like I did in the book of Acts, when the persecution arose, so did my power come down in greater measure. Come on, somebody shout, these are exciting days. Hallelujah. I call it the persecution PowerPoint. For every time persecution comes against the church, comes against the people of this book, the word of God, God said, I'll increase my power. We got people preaching about a revival's coming. It is, but it's going to ride the wings of persecution. Hello? The Holy Ghost told me last night, he said, go warn my people. There's about to be another outbreak of hell in our nation in places. And they're going to call it revival. He said, but it won't be mine. Because it'll be a revival without repentance. Hello? Somebody shout, a revival without repentance. We had one probably 6 or 7 years ago right down in Lakeland, Florida. Come on, somebody. I was invited during that time. I had to preach in Tampa, Florida. And somebody invited me to come by. Dylan was with me. And went in the service that night. Got so sick, they put me in a reserve place for preachers and had the band on my wrist, and I was down close. I had to go because I had to get out and go to the restroom. I was got sick on my stomach. Then my boy got sick, and I was standing at the back of that big, huge place that was nothing but a tent. And the Holy Ghost spoke to me. He said, I'm not in this. Somebody run by me, and the Holy Ghost said, I'm not in this, and this soon shall fall. The man of God that welcomed me to come and invited me, I looked at him and I told him, or I didn't look at him, I called him from the motel room because I was still sick. I called him from the motel room and told him I had to leave, and I said, these are the words of the Lord. This is not of the Holy Spirit. I said, it will fall. Many of their faith shall be destroyed because of this. I said, it may have begun in the spirit, but it no longer is. Yeah. Hello? Amen. 2 months later, this was 2 months before all that happened. If anybody remembers. Amen. Evangelist committed adultery and come to find out he was drinking alcohol during the revival. Between services. Praise the Lord God. Hallelujah. But the Holy Ghost told me last night, he brought that up back in my spirit. Friend, you got to hear something. You got to hear something. We're living in days of deception. And Jesus said in Matthew 24 and verses 3. Listen to this. He said, beware lest any man deceive you. That's the first warning Jesus gave. Yeah. Don't be deceived. And you'll hear these people that, so to speak, have these moves of God. They're wordless moves. They spend more time preaching their testimonies and showing testimonies of miracles, signs, and wonders. They don't preach. They get really excited and they have a lot of emotional thrills and falls. Come on, somebody. And ups and downs. And come on. Amen. But they never preach. You see them on your TV now a lot of times, especially late at night. Come on, somebody. All they do is give a scripture here and there and want you to give some money, and they show testimony after testimony, but they don't preach. They can prophesy, but they don't preach. Jesus said in Matthew 15, amen, and he taught, he said, the day is going to come. He said, will you profess, amen, you know me with your mouth. Come on. Hallelujah. And you're going to say, well, we prophesied in your name. We did great and mighty works in your name. We cast out devils in your name. But Jesus is going to say, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. I never knew you. Come on, somebody. What a tragedy. They had all the emotional highs of what revival brings, but there was no message of repentance. Somebody shout, real revival will have the message of the cross. If they're not preaching the blood of the Lamb and the cross, if they're not preaching repentance of sin, do not be deceived by all the falling down, come on, and the jumping up and the highs. Come on, anybody hear the Holy Ghost? Because I'm telling you, that so-called move had all that.
Yeah. Amen.
It had the latest sounds of music of worship. Come on, anybody hear the Holy Ghost? But where was the cross at? There was messages come out of that thing like this, and you can look it up on YouTube. I know it's got to be still there. There was messages came out of that so-called move that were nothing more than this right here. All the church believes in Jesus, but God spoke to me and told me, amen, that the church, amen, don't believe in the supernatural no more. They don't have no trouble believing in Jesus, but they don't believe in the angel. Where you find in your Bible? Come on, somebody shout, believe in Jesus is believing in the supernatural. He is the one, come on, somebody, that does the signs and the wonders and the miracles. Somewhere along the way, people got detoured. Amen, praise God. And they believed a lie just because they saw somebody falling out or because they saw some documented miracle. Come on, Satan's got lying wonders too. And the Holy Spirit said in these last days in times of deception, people's going to want to scream out for something authentic and so real because of the persecution and because of the evil of our times. They'll just reach out and grab anything. But somebody shout, if you can't find it in the book, you better run from it. But there will be an authentic move of God. The revival that comes from Holy Spirit will come on the wings of persecution. Hello. Hallelujah. And the sound of his message in this revival won't be money's coming. God's going to make you rich. But the sound that you'll hear in God's move in this last hour, in the middle of persecution, and God with signs and wonders moves authentically among his people, will be Jesus is coming. It'll be a reaping revival. Come on, somebody. It won't be called healing revival. It won't be tagged with any other sign or wonder. Come on, somebody. It'll be a revival to bring in the masses that are lost before Jesus returns. Amen. And the subject and the theme will be Jesus is coming. It'll be the cross. It'll be the blood of the Lamb. It'll be repent and turn from your sin. Hallelujah. Praise God. Somebody say you enjoy the first message. Praise God. Hallelujah. Take your Bible and turn to Nehemiah 11. Message 2. Nehemiah 11, we're going to just read a part of verse 17, then we're going to skip on over in the Word of God to probably Psalms 106. Nehemiah 11. And you know, by the way, they some people, I've heard people make statements like this. Well, don't you dare judge some move, and they call it of God. Don't you never judge it until you've experienced it. Where is that in the Bible? Where do I have to experience something before I can judge it righteously? I ain't got to commit suicide to judge that it's wrong. Anybody still breathing? I don't have to go indulge in the sin before I can discern whether it's wrong. I don't have to be deceived first to know it's deception. Amen. His word is truth. John 17 and 17. The entrance of his word gives light. Psalms 119, 130. Somebody shout, his word's enough. Wherever the word of God is that's spoken in truth, it exposes darkness. Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So be warned. You'll hear statements like it. You're going to hear statements like, oh, don't you judge this. This is the move of God until you've experienced it.
Praise God.
Hello? No, I don't have to be deceived before I can discern whether it's deception or not.
That's right. Praise God.
Oh, glory. Anyhow, that's just some nuggets for somebody. You're going to see it. It's going to happen. You're going to see it spring up in places.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, it's going to spring up in the north and it's going to come south. Often it sprung up in the south first, but God said it'll spring up in the north. It'll come south. Just all over America. Hello. Give me these little lion moves. Hear me. You won't hear the cross. You won't hear the blood of the Lamb. And you'll hear put your faith in something other than Jesus. Jesus will be mentioned, but angels will be a big thing. You know, I am prophesying. I am not preaching. I'm telling you things to come. John 16 and 13. You know? He's coming, but there's some things coming.
Yes.
Hello? Because people's going to be in such a day where they're so stressed out, they're just going to reach out for anything. And Satan's going to bring a counterfeit.
Yeah.
And some of these ministers that you at one time watched and applauded and said amen and felt the power of God to, they have already been being sucked in for some season now. Many of them, amen, are going to go right along with this. They're going to be sucked up in it, and you're just going to be on their wave too.
Right.
Hear the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Amen. The theme is money, being rich. Come on, church. Miracle signs and wonders. And they'll do more of their advertising of this so-called move, amen, by testimonies. Hello? And little hashtag sayings that sound good, but they won't preach.
Yeah.
Remember that. There won't be much preaching done. Mm-hmm. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
All right. Message two, finally. Amen. Nehemiah 11, verse 17. And I'm not going to read all of it, but I just got to make this point to begin with. And Mattaniah, the son of Micaiah, the son of Zebadiah, somebody shout, the Ayahs. And the son of Asaph was the principal to begin. Principal meaning the leader, to begin the thanksgiving in prayer. Say that with me.
The thanksgiving.
In prayer. They didn't just have a thanksgiving, they called it the thanksgiving. This was the sacrifice of thanksgiving, where they would take an animal, they would slay it. Come on, somebody. They would bake certain cakes and offer drink offerings and cake offerings to the Lord. Amen. It's found in the book of Leviticus. And we find this was during a season where Nehemiah was sent by God, appointed and anointed by God to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. The walls that were served as their protection. Come on, somebody. Their defense against enemies.
Praise God.
It could represent a standard, come on somebody, of righteousness. These walls have been torn down. And the only way God's people could stand against the enemy of their time is these walls had to be rebuilt.
Come on, man.
And in the process of rebuilding them, somebody shout, they had the thanksgiving.
Yeah.
Not just a thanksgiving, but the thanksgiving.
Yeah.
And notice they said it must begin, somebody say, in prayer.
In prayer.
Wow. You realize, and I'm going to use this to set up where I'm going to, because I'm going to bring us to 1863 on October the 3rd with the 16th President of the United States, Abraham Lincoln, in just a moment, and show you that the first Thanksgiving was at an altar, not a table.
Amen.
First Thanksgiving was a Thanksgiving fast, not a Thanksgiving feast.
Praise God.
Somebody's thinking, oh God, you telling me we got to fast this coming Thursday? I hope Lord leads you. Last year I did. I waited till that night before I ate the bread. He was a little drier than he would have been at lunchtime, but still. Come on, somebody. Amen. But that's between you and God. But I just want to show you, history reveals his story. Come on, somebody, and where it really come from. But even in the old covenant, even in this day, we see that Nehemiah and these rulers, amen, glory to God, here they are about to rebuild the defense of God, the standards of God, raise up the standard again, the walls, come on, somebody, against the enemy, put something between them and the enemy.
Praise God.
Hello? And they said, let's begin the thanksgiving, which was the sacrifice of thanksgiving. Somebody say, in prayer. Somebody shout, the thanksgiving altar. If I could have a title, it'd be that. The thanksgiving altar. Not the table. Somebody say, the altar. That's exactly, amen, where the thanksgiving, and because in, during the sacrifice of thanksgiving, at the altar they'd slay an animal. It would be at the altar, amen, that they brought, if they brought anything to eat, they brought it for the Lord. They brought a cake offering. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. They brought a drink offering and they poured it out to the Lord. Somebody say, to the Lord. Somebody shout, they cooked for Jesus. Amen. They brought him something. Praise God. Hallelujah. And the sacrifice of their best animal, their lamb or whatever from their flock. Amen. They brought it to the altar of the Lord and sacrificed it unto him. Now we see that the best lamb has been sacrificed for us. He's Jesus. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Amen. Our Passover has been sacrificed for us. 2 Corinthians 5:7. Somebody say it's Christ. That's what 1 Corinthians 5 says. Christ, our Passover, has been been sacrificed for us. So God no longer requires a sacrifice of thanksgiving in this sense, where I've got to bring him a cake and a drink offering and pour it out on the altar, amen, or bring my best animal from my flock, amen, and slit its throat and shed blood, because God's always chose the shedding of blood, come on somebody, for remission of sin. But in this day it only lasted once a year, praise God, or for 1 year, amen, but the blood of Jesus, come on somebody, cleanses us from all our sin. 1 John 1:7, the blood of Jesus was so perfect, amen, glory to God, just one drop, amen, glory to God, could cover and wash away the sins of all humanity in his day, in our day, in any day to come, throughout the rest of time. That's how powerful the blood of Jesus is. So God says, I don't require sacrifice. David said in Psalms 51 verse 16, he said, the Lord, amen, does not require a sacrifice, or else I would give it. He delights not in burnt offerings. That's verse 16. But Psalms 51:17 said, but the Lord, hello, his sacrifice, the sacrifice of God, is a broken and contrite spirit, and a broken and contrite spirit he will not despise or reject. In other words, David said, God no longer requires these sacrifices. But what he does require as a sacrifice is a broken heart at the altar. Somebody say a broken heart.
Broken heart.
A heart, come on somebody, that is broken in godly sorrow over sin. Over disobedience. Over doing things their way instead of God's way. Turning back to God. Becoming broken before God. Psalms 34 and 18. The Bible said the Lord is near unto them that be of a broken heart. Psalms chapter 138, I believe it is. Or Psalms 136, thank you Lord. In verses 6 said, the Lord is far from the proud. Friend, Micah 6 and 8 says, walk humbly with your God. If you don't humble yourself before God, you can't walk with this God. Come on somebody. The God of the B-I-B-L-E. He rejects the proud. Those that are full of their own righteousness. Come on. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? Because our righteousness, our good deeds, our works, is nothing but filthy rags. Isaiah 64 and verses 6. Hallelujah. For God says, my sacrifice is a broken heart. Somebody say, at the altar. Not a sacrifice laid on an altar of some animal or some gift you bring. But the sacrifice I want now is you. I want you to be broken before me. Not some animal. You. And in Psalms 50 verses 9, God spoke to David. He said, tell my people, I will no longer take a bullock out of your house. A bullock would be a bull that they would come to sacrifice on the altar of the Lord. God said, I no longer want your bullocks. Look at your neighbor. God's saying the same thing today. He said to the modern church. Come on, tell him. Say, he's saying to the modern church, I don't want your bull no more. And the church went, I don't want your bull church attendance if I can't have your heart. I don't want your bull hand raised if I can't have your heart. I don't want your bull preaching, your bull teaching. I don't want your bull singing if you won't give me your heart. Who cares if you can sing good? If I ain't got your heart, hallelujah, I don't want nothing you got to offer. I don't want your bull time, your bull attendance. I don't want your bull coming to church. Come on, somebody, if you won't give me your heart. Somebody shout, God wants broken hearts, not bull. Hallelujah. How you get that out of them scriptures, Holy Ghost? Amen. Amen. Because bull stinks. And ain't nothing worse that stinks in the nostrils of God or those that have come to his house. Come on, somebody. And clap with everybody that claps. Sing with everybody that sings. Come on. Occasionally give something in an offer. Sacrifice their time on Sunday. But as soon as church is over, they go right back to their sin. Go right back to their iniquity lifestyles. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. God said that's bull. And there's people in hell that had this bull religion.
Yes.
Somebody say, to hell with this bull religion. In Moses' day, they worshipped a bull, a fatted calf they'd made out of gold. So God says, anything that you do without giving me your heart that you say you're doing for me is idolatry. He said, you can draw nigh to me with your mouth and honor me with your lips, but if your heart is far from me, you then worship me in vain and teach doctrines as the commandments, come on, of men. Yeah. Praise God, that's Matthew 15, verse 8 and 9. So he said, your vain, your worship becomes vain. Somebody say, vain worship.
Vain worship.
Your thanksgiving, your praise, it becomes vain. It's empty. It's worthless. You say with your mouth, you love me. You say with your mouth, we praise you. You say with your mouth, thank you, God. Come on, somebody. When you receive your award from the world, and you praise me for giving it to you, and then the songs you sang was about getting drunk and having sex. Come on, I didn't give you them songs. Don't thank me for that you got. That little award you're going to sit on your cabinet to collect dust with. Come on. I didn't give you that.
Come on.
But your heart's far from me. You vain, you worship them becomes vain in me. See, a heart that's far from him, not broken before him, not surrendered to him, amen, making still worship, but it's vain because it's far off worship. Come on, just far enough to keep my sin and still say, I praise you, Lord. I believe you, God. Hallelujah. James 2 and 19 said, devils believe and tremble. The devil's got that kind of faith. He don't live for God. Come on, somebody, but he still believes. So what you can believe? People's in hell. People's in hell. Believers are in hell who believe. Believed in a distance worshiped. And like Judas, the Bible said that Judas came and kissed Jesus, gave him a little peck, a little religious peck on the cheek.
That's right.
Amen. That's what it said in Matthew 26. And Jesus told him in verse 5, not Finn, but Matthew 26, verse 50. Jesus, speaking of lips, let me grieve about. Right here, you know. I don't get stuck no more. Hallelujah. He said, friend, wherefore art thou come? Jesus looked at Judas and called him friend, knowing that Judas was betraying him and betraying him with a kiss. And Jesus said that statement in Luke 22 and 48. He said, why betray you, the Son of Man, with a kiss?
Praise God.
You know the word kiss, both in Hebrew and Greek, means to worship. Judas's name is derived from the word Judah, which we know in Hebrew means praise, or to be praised. Oh, glory to God. So Judas, whose name is derived from praise, betrays Jesus with a praise. Somebody say it, betray praise. Kissing Jesus. But in his heart, he's far away. People come to church all the time, like, know you, Jesus. But they won't give him their heart. Their vain worship. It's bull to him. It stinks. Come on, hear the Holy Ghost. Lamentation 3:41, or verse 40 and 41 said, let us search and try our ways and turn again unto the Lord. Let us lift up our hearts. Somebody say our hearts. With our hands unto God who dwells in the heavens. That's Lamentation 3, verse 40 and 41. God says right here, amen, when you come and worship me, first lift your heart, then lift your hands. Because if you're lifting your hands before you've lifted your heart, come on, somebody, I don't accept it. I don't receive it. Wow. So you can say, thank you, God. But if you hadn't broke your heart before him at the altar and turned from your sin and believed on his sacrifice, his only begotten son, what he did on that cross, your worship is rejected. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? I didn't write the book. He did. Somebody say the Thanksgiving altar. Thanksgiving began in prayer. Nehemiah 11:17, during Nehemiah's time. And this was again the time where they were building up a wall of defense, a standard between them and the enemy that would want to destroy their lives. Hallelujah. Praise God. Satan ain't afraid of people that can raise their hands. And some of these false so-called movements I talked about earlier and warned you about that's going to start springing up in this nation again. And that don't mean the authentic ain't going to be here. God's going to have the real. Hallelujah. Amen. But you'll see some of the most hyper worship you ever seen in your life. Hello? Amen? This one I made mention of, they praise and shout, but he was drinking alcohol between services. Getting a little hot.
high there, Toddy, for the body. Amen?
Yes.
Wow. Yeah. Praise God.
Thank you, Jesus. So be careful with this. God wants the heart. Somebody shout, that's true Thanksgiving. When He has your heart. If He don't have you, you'd say thank you, God, but you're not thanking God. Because just like Judas, he gave Jesus some lip service. And look at your neighbor and say, Jesus wants more than... Some lady, her husband, looked down and she was thinking, God, it's been a while. Come on. Sir, you ought to kiss your wife every minute. More then than, you know. Praise God. Amen. But He wants more than that. He wants your heart. Heart means He wants your life. He don't want your blood pumping muscle. Your heart means your spirit, your life. Come on. The core of who you are, your everything. That's what He shed His blood on the cross for. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. So we've established that. Let's go over to Psalms 106. Psalms 106. I'm not going to read the entirety of this psalm. If I did, it'd be 48 verses. Hallelujah. And somebody was thinking, oh, God will eat tonight. Because He ain't quoted but just a few. If He reads 48.
Oh, whatever.
Woo! Amen. Well, Paul, be wild for you go get that ice. We just have ice water if you go get it right now. Oh. This is a psalm of thanksgiving, of praise for the mercy of God that endures forever. Now I want you to see this nation, Israel. David speaks of this time and see some of the contrast that we see today in this nation. I still want you to see this. He starts off, says, praise ye the Lord. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for He is good, for His mercy endureth forever. Yes. Somebody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Somebody shout, for He's good.
For He's good.
Somebody shout, He got more good than the devil does bad.
He got more good.
You ought to praise the Lord.
Amen.
I know this ain't good English, but I ain't an English teacher. He got more gooder than the devil does bad. Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
Well, around the Marvin, life's been bad. God still got more good.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
David said, give Him thanks. Because He's good. Psalms 92 and 1 says, give thanks unto the Lord. Amen. And sing praises. He said, do a good thing and give thanks to the Lord and sing Him praise. Somebody say, you ought to do a good thing. Give Him thanks. That's Psalms 92 verses 1. Amen. Hallelujah. So he said, here's my purpose of giving Him praise and saying thank you. He's good.
Yes.
Yes. Don't you ever forget that. He's a good God.
Good God.
Yeah. Hey! Yeah. Hallelujah.
Yeah. He been gooder to us than we have been Him.
Come on, somebody. Yes. Amen. Remember, the gospel is still good news.
Yes.
Amen.
It's only good, though, when you've heard the bad news. And here's the bad news. Soul that sins shall surely die. Thereafter, once that's declared and affixed, praise God, then the gospel makes sense. Amen. Him on the cross. And listen, he talks about His mercy enduring forever. His mercy would mean His loving kindness. His mercy meaning I don't deserve His forgiveness. Look at your neighbor and say, anything you receive from God, you don't deserve. Some think they've somehow earned what they have in God. They have but one earned anything that any of us receive, and that's Christ on the cross.
Amen.
No, He's the only one that deserves any praise whatsoever.
Amen.
Amen. It's called the gift of God. Thanks be unto God for His everlasting, His unspeakable gift. Praise God. 1 Corinthians 9:15, that's Jesus. Amen. That Paul made reference of. Somebody say, thanks be unto God for His unspeakable gift. Paul couldn't even find words to describe this gift called Jesus. Come on, somebody. So he just said, thank you, Lord. Praise and thanks is a language in its own. Come on, somebody. Because you can't find words, amen, to say what He means to you. So you have to go to the highest word you can find. And it's hallelujah, praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah.
Praise God. And he said it's because of His mercy. Then he talks about His mighty praises or His mighty acts. He goes on and and how God visits his people with salvation and his chosen, and they all rejoice and they're glad. But then by verse 6, it kind of changes. He said, we have sinned with our fathers, and we have committed iniquity and have done wickedly. Verse 7, our fathers understood not thy wonders in Egypt. They remembered not the multitude of thy mercies, but provoked him at the sea, even at the Red Sea. Remember, they started doubting him. Verses 8, nevertheless, he saved them for his name's sake, that he might make his mighty power to be known. Somebody shout, that's the reason he saves us. For himself. So he can make his power known through us. Come on. And it talks about how he rebuked the Red Sea and dried it all up, and they walked through the wilderness, and he saved them out of the hand of him that hated him, redeemed them from the hand of the enemy, and waters covered their enemy, talking about how the Red Sea closed down behind them on their enemy. But listen, after all that, then believed they his words, and they sang his praise. Hello? I reckon it took them that long to find and say, okay, let's have faith in God. Man, after they done seen some, I'm talking about some ridiculous, miraculous signs and wonders. And it took them up to this point after the water fell on Pharaoh's army that they, let's believe him and get our praise on.
Come on now.
Somebody shout, if you believe, you will praise him.
Yeah.
If you don't believe, you just sit quiet. You don't praise.
Oh,
amen. Amen. But listen, think this a description of this nation. They soon forgot his works. 9/11. Oh, praise you, God. Nobody afraid to say Jesus then. Hey, all you on Sunday morning, like this morning, you sitting at the house on 9/11, you was trying to find a church. You couldn't get enough of church.
Come on now.
How soon they forgot his words. They waited not for his counsel. God, I ain't got time to wait to hear from God. Let's just go ahead and make our plans and get it done. Right. People do that every Sunday. Praise God, they want God to move, but they ain't got time to listen to preach. Preach, my God, are you ever going to shut up? I listen what they did. But lusted. Boy, ain't this America. This homosexual marriage and lesbian marriage and all that our Supreme Court has sit around, these Supreme Justices who's balled their fist up in the face of God and says, I know in the book of Genesis you define marriage as one man and one woman, but we're going to redefine it. We're going to be God now.
Yeah, Lord. Listen up.
We're going to play God since 1973, and we're going to say, hey man, that ain't life inside that woman's womb. They've lusted exceedingly in the wilderness, and they tempted God in the desert. Listen what he does. He give them their request. Somebody shout, he let them do what they want. He let them have their same-sex marriage. He's let them have what they want to have. He's let them do it. That's part of his judgment. Okay? It's what you want. You think this will work? You don't want to do it my way? Go ahead and do it your way. Listen, they envied Moses also in the camp and Aaron, the saint of the Lord. Notice they turn against God's anointed. No longer have respect for God's chosen, God's anointed, those that speak the words of the Lord. And God brought judgment. He opened the earth and swallowed up Dathan and covered the company of Abiram. And fire was kindled in their company and flame burned upon the wicked. They made a calf in Horeb and worshiped them. Can you imagine that? After God, can you imagine God says, okay, I'm going to use this earthquake and I'm going to swallow up all these heathens that's fighting against my anointed. And they were all swallowed up. The earth opened up, earthquake, he closed back up. Fire.
My Lord.
Immediately thereafter, the people that watched this take place went out, took all their gold, melted it down, and made themselves a golden calf.
Yeah.
Look at your neighbor and say, and you thought you had some messed up folk in your family. If God can do something with this bunch, surely yours ain't no problem. Amen. They changed their glory into the similitude of an ox that eateth grass. They forgot God their Savior, which had done great things in Egypt. Wondrous works in the land of Ham. Somebody's thinking, I'd like to go to that land now. Hurry up and get through. It's in there waiting for me. You smell it, don't you? Right out that door is the land of Ham.
Oh,
Look at your neighbor and say, don't you lust in the wilderness.
Don't you lust in the wilderness.
You better wait for God's counsel. Hey, amen. 22 said, wondrous works in the land of Ammon, terrible, awesome things by the Red Sea. Therefore, he said unto them that he would destroy them, had not Moses, his chosen, stood before him in the breach or in the gap to turn away his wrath, lest they should be destroyed them. Moses stood between God and the people. God said, I'm going to swipe this whole nation out. I'm going to kill them all. Moses stood up, you know, before the Lord. You've read it. Amen. And he said, Lord, blot my name out of the book. Amen. God turned in his wrath because of one man. He's crying out. And you think just one person don't amount to nothing before God. One saint crying out to God. I believe that's why the judgment of God had hit this nation in its severity, though it has come in waves, but not in its severity, because there's still saints that cry out like David's talking about here. We've committed iniquity, we've sinned, and our fathers. In other words, he's praying like he sinned, though he may not. And he's crying out for his nation, his own people. Moses did it. Verse 24 said, they despised the pleasant land and believed not his word. They murmured in their tents. Remember, when he was trying to give them the promised land, all they do is murmur and complain. He lifted up his hand against them, overthrew them in the wilderness. Their seed and the nations, he scattered them in the lands. Verse 28, they joined themselves unto Baal Peor. Baal, you know, Baal worship, and I've preached that here often before. Baal worship was worship that was done on the altar of Baal, which happened since we speak in a bull. He was half bull and half man. That was his image. At his altar, between his knees in that area, was a fire that would burn, and they threw their newborn children in the fire. The stench of their children's burning flesh. And then they'd have sexual orgies all over the altars of Baal. Males with males, females with females, and males with females, vice versa. Just openly everywhere. Come on, somebody. And they'd erect the sex organ of a man, praise God, beside Baal. Amen. And that's pornography. And we see all this in our nation today. Baal worship has been changed. It's little flowery terms now. It's not called human sacrifice. It's called abortion. Where they burn babies' bodies. Hello? And people want to look at what Hitler did to the Jews, which was a great sin. Come on, somebody, and how he burned bodies. But we in this nation, we make Hitler look like an amateur. Because since Roe versus Wade in 1973, 57 million plus babies have been slain and killed in their mother's womb in this nation. We have sown mass murder in private. Now, for the last several years, we're reaping it publicly. We're reaping it in movie theaters. We're reaping it in schools. We're reaping it, come on, somebody, in marathon runs. We're reaping it in public. We're reaping it on 9/11. People don't like to hear that. Yeah. Who's a terrorist? Yeah. I'm telling you, the leaders in this nation and every person with this left agenda that says it's okay to murder babies and call it abortion, come on somebody, and it's okay to have these sexual perversions, which ain't nothing but modern bell worship of homosexual marriage and lesbian marriage, same-sex marriage. Amen. They're the same spirit that operated in this day that God is speaking about here in this nation that brought his judgment. Come on, anybody hear the Holy Ghost? And anybody on this left or any leader in this nation that says, I support homosexual marriage, amen, and abortion is nothing more than the terrorists themselves. Even you, dear sir and ma'am,
yes,
amen. Make the modern terrorist with their jihad agenda look like amateurs. Amen. You've slain more than they've ever thought about.
Yes.
Hello?
Amen.
One terrorist beheads their victim, while another, with law and legislation in their pen, allows a doctor to take his scissors, jam up while the baby's head's still in the womb and its feet's hanging out dangling, and stick a syringe up in the back of its neck poke a hole while its little feet's kicking on the outside of the womb, because it's still legal long as the head's inside. And suck that baby's brains out. Hello? One guy walking into a church or in a school, demon possessed, popping caps in people, blowing their heads off. Come on, somebody. Shooting them. Amen. Mass murder. We call that illegal. Amen. Glory to God. But our screwed up, demonized politicians in this nation. Come on. And our president's one of them too. Come on, church. Say it's okay. Amen. For a doctor to take his, amen, scissors and cut a hole back here and shove a tube up in that baby. Amen. And suck their brains out. And then they take their bodies and burn them. Who's a terrorist?
That's right.
We've got to defend life.
Really? And you killing the unborn life?
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Hello? Yeah. Anybody hear the whole... Man, that's terrorism. Terrorism's been in America a long time. Yeah. And I ain't talking about ISIS. Right. I'm talking about Washington, D.C. and politicians who say it's okay to kill that baby. The baby that's unborn's been terrorized and mass murdered, 57 million plus and counting, over 3,000 a day in this nation. When we going after ISIS, somebody needs to go after some politicians.
That's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
What you mean go kill them? No, I ain't talking about go kill them. Get them out of office.
That's right.
If saints who really believe this Bible, come on, would practice their rights that men and women in uniform for centuries has died for, would go when it's time to vote, these leaders wouldn't be in where they at, making these laws that they're making. Defying our Constitution that they're defying. So the blood don't just drip from their hands. It drips from the so-called Christian community. Come on, somebody. Even these preachers that got mega churches. Come on, somebody. Amen. That rub elbows with Oprah. Come on, and everybody else. Come on. Amen. But they don't have no conviction in their message. They're like the Pope. Amen. They come and they just in unity. Amen. And don't hurt nobody's feelings. But they ain't the prophets of the Bible, because they did that. Tell their leaders like John did, Herod, repent. Like Elijah, amen, did Ahab repent? You're the one causing the trouble.
Yes.
Blood trickles down. All the way back to the pulpits. All the way back to the houses of so-called worship. The blood of the innocent. The innocent unborn child. ISIS beheads their victim. Politicians and those on the left and their agenda in this nation, they use a vacuum to suck the brains out of theirs. One demonized gun-carrying kid in a school can kill people, and they call it illegal. But what they do with the unborn baby, they call it legal. Hello? People think immediately about Hitler in hell because of all what he did. Man, there's a department in hell that goes way deeper than where Hitler is. All those people that supports abortion, my God, have mercy, except they repent. Amen. Another day, another night. Another precious unborn life will never see the light of day. Will never run or jump or play. This is nothing more than the sacrifice of your greenback God.
Yes.
You call choice.
Yes.
Hello? Jesus. Hear the Holy Ghost. My friend, I'm telling you, there's a day coming. There's coming a payday at the end of time. Where God said the innocent slain their blood like Abel's, that cried out in Genesis 4 from the ground in verses 10 against his brother Cain. Glory to God, is crying out in masses. I want you to know, little babies may have not had a voice in this earth, but their blood's had a voice before the throne of God since 73. And there's not one baby that's been mass murdered, amen, inside of its mother's womb, amen, that's went voiceless before God. And God said, I will bring judgment. I will bring it swift when it comes. Come on, I want you to know. Leaders of the nation, you may run after ISIS, but if you say it's okay to kill babies in the womb, I got to tell you something. In God's eyes, you're a terrorist, and he's coming for you. Yeah. You better repent. Yeah. Hey. Yeah. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
That's right.
Preach, you act mad.
Lord.
I am.
Hallelujah.
Come on now.
Going to defend life.
Thank you,
really. You kill them. Before they can even get born. You hypocrite.
Yes.
Hallelujah. They join themselves to Baal PR. Now Baal PR, PR in Hebrew means gap. This is Psalms 106:28. He's called the Lord of the Oak, the Lord of the Gap. I call it the gap God, lowercase God. And they provoke God to anger with their inventions. And a plague break out among them. Somebody say diseases. Then there was one man of God named Phinehas. His name means mouth of the serpent. He executes judgment so the plague would stop. And if you'll read the account, it's in Numbers 25. What happened? Some of the men in the nation of Israel came to the temple with these heathen harlots that they were having sexual intercourse with. Brought them up to the temple during the sacrifices. Brought them in. No fear of God. Brought their sin right up in his house. Brought their sin and just played it right in front of him. It's going on in America. People come and sit in churches. Preachers stand in pulpits. Come on, somebody. And they sleeping around. People fornicating. Sexual sins. All up in the church. And this is the way it was. Amen. And Phinehas stood up and took a spear and went over and killed both of them. Now somebody ought to thank God right there for his mercy.
Amen.
There'd be a whole lot of dead folk in the church today. Thank God for the blood of the cross. There's forgiveness. You don't have to. You can forgive them. Praise God. But in that time, the blood of Jesus hadn't been shed. Jesus hadn't been sacrificed on the cross. So a plague broke out among them, and the only way it was stopped is the one sinning had to be killed. Now the sin can be killed. Praise God. And God's mercy was released, and the plague was stopped because of this one man. I call it sheep gone wild. Read it in Numbers 25. The people of God bucked wild, went wild. They thought they could come to the house of God and sacrifice and worship, but they brought their little sexual sins with them, unrepented. Dancing before the Lord, playing around before the Lord, God struck them dead. Hello? Because they had no fear of God. And people are doing that Sunday after Sunday. They come into the house of God. Somebody say, sheep gone wild. Every sexual perversion you can imagine, they're indulging in. But oh, we love you, Jesus. Here's my offering. Oh, God bless y'all. I need prayer. God said, keep your bull.
That's right.
I don't want no bull from your house, Psalms 50 verse 9, but here's the sacrifice I want. I want a sacrifice of the thanksgiving. Amen. I want your heart to break, because that's the only sacrifice I receive is that of a broken heart. I'll not despise it. Psalms 51 verse 17. Somebody shout, that's the sacrifice of thanksgiving. It ain't raising my hand coming to church on Sunday. Amen. But it's saying, God, here's my heart. I turn from my sin. Hosea 14 verses 1 and verses 2. The Bible said, God spoke through Hosea the prophet. He said, O Israel. Amen. He said, you have went away from your God, but turned to the Lord your God. You have fallen in by your iniquity. Amen. He said, take with you words and turn unto the Lord and say unto him, take away our iniquity. Receive us graciously and we will give forth the calves of our lips. Ain't that amazing? The prophet said, we'll bring forth the calves of our lips. Look at your neighbor and say, last time I checked, my calves weren't on my lips. Well, if your neighbor said, neither was my hips on my lips. Amen. But calves, he weren't talking about legs there. He was literally talking about the bull. Now, Hosea said, you've sinned, you've turned away from God. He was talking to a nation. He said, turn back to God, and when you do, bring words. But more than words, he wants your heart and say, Lord, take away our iniquity. We have sinned. Receive us graciously. That's the message of repentance. They were repenting. Their hearts were broken. And they weren't just saying with words, Lord. It was from their heart. And they said, then we'll render, give you the calves of our limbs. Ain't it amazing that the prophet said they would bring God a sacrifice of thanksgiving? But he used the word calves of our lips. See, God didn't want their sacrificial animals. He didn't want all that. He wanted the calves of their lips. In other words, he wanted a pure sacrifice that came from their heart through their lips. Come on, you see what he's saying? Hebrews 13 and 15 said it this way. Let us continually, amen, bring the sacrifice of praise unto God, amen, through Jesus, being thankful unto him in his name. Somebody shout the sacrifice of praise. Psalm 16 and 17, David said, he said, I'll offer to him the sacrifice of thanksgiving and I will call on his name. David didn't call out to God until he brought him a sacrifice of thanksgiving. And the sacrifice of thanksgiving, amen, was not just thank you God. But no, it was a heart at the altar. Somebody shout, it was the thanksgiving altar. It was the altar where they brought their thanksgiving and they rendered their heart. Come on, somebody. And they gave God the sacrifice. Official thanks of their lips because their heart was broken and they were thanking him for his mercy. They were thanking him. They deserved his judgment, but instead he gave them forgiveness. He gave them mercy and they were overwhelmed. Hallelujah.
Hey, Thanksgiving. And in our day, Thanksgiving has become
thank you, or I'm thankful. That ain't Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving ain't just, I'm thankful. I'm thankful for this. Thanksgiving is directed to a person.
Hello? And if I go to some restaurant and they ain't even got common courtesy no more, I'll usually say stuff like this. They ain't even say nothing to you. And I'll say, you're welcome.
That's right.
Just common courtesy.
Yeah.
Meaning I'm trying to tell them you don't even say thank you.
That's right.
Tell them. You realize we didn't have a job. I didn't come in and eat this stuff.
Right.
And the rest of us, least you could do was thank you for your business. Thank you for coming. But no, so wow. Tell people that all the time. Praise God. But thanks is unto somebody. Say God. Praise God. And thanks unto God ain't just a hand raise. Again, Lamentations 3:41 said you lift your heart with your hands. Somebody say, your heart with your hands. Not just your hands, your heart. You come to church on this Sunday before Thanksgiving, the last Thursday of November, traditionally, seasonally, and say, thank you, God. But if you don't give him your life, you don't give him your heart, you're unthankful. So we're not just thankful, we're full of thanks toward God because of his mercy. Somebody say, his mercy. And listen, we find out, and I'm going to go on down to verse 37 of Psalms 106. He said, yea, now this describes America, though he was speaking to Israel this time. They sacrificed their sons and their daughters unto devils. To false gods. Baal. Remember, they slayed their own kids. Shed innocent blood. Somebody said, there's abortion. Even the blood of their sons and their daughters whom they sacrificed unto idols of Canaan. And the land was polluted with blood. America ain't America the beautiful, she's America the bloody. Thus they were defiled with their own works and went a whoring after their own inventions. Verse 40, therefore was the wrath of the Lord kindled against the people insomuch that he abhorred his own inheritance. He gave them into the hand of the heathen, and they hated him, them ruled over them. Their enemies also oppressed them and were brought into subjection under their hands. I don't care. The greatest military minds, the greatest political minds that can sit in a room with all the wealth that can be distributed to make military strong cannot even come close to defeating a nation's enemies when that nation is in open rebellion against God, slaying innocent blood of her own. See, a horse is prepared in the day of battle, but safety is of the Lord, Proverbs 21:31. The horse in David's or Solomon's day would have been like, amen, our military today. You can prepare all militarily and politically and with all the wealth you got accumulated to make your armies great and mighty.
You'd be proud of your big military. But God says, don't you ever forget, safety is of the Lord. According to Psalms 106, beginning in verse 37 right here, God said, if you slay innocent blood, I'll turn you over to your enemies and let them rule over you.
Come on now.
Wow. You kill your innocent unborn children, I'll turn you over to all your enemies and they'll seem so small in what they have and all the greatness you've got, and they'll overtake you. All your might will amount to nothing against all their little might, because you kill innocent unborn children, you slay innocent blood, God said, I'll turn your enemies loose on you. That's what's going on in America. That's what's going on in other nations of this world. Cave people. Come on, somebody. People that ain't even got no Air Force. It's coming in our nation and the nations of this world got everybody disturbed and they don't know what to do with them. Hello, but God says until this nation and leaders and the nations of nations stand up and say we have sinned against the God of the Bible, we have killed our unborn children, we've redefined what marriage is with our fist in your face, God forgive us and turn from their sin, the enemies that we see will only prevail and continue to enhance in spite of all our wealth and all our military mind. Anybody hear Holy Ghost? It's right here in your book. God said their enemies also oppressed them. Why? Because verse 37, they've sacrificed their sons and daughters unto devils and they've shed innocent blood, the blood of their sons and daughters. That's why I let their enemies overtake them. Hello? As tragic as it was on 9/11, the lives that were slain innocently, even more tragic is it. Do you realize what happened on 9/11 in one day in this nation? More babies are killed than what was slain then. Wow. Listen, verse 43, many times did he deliver them. Boy, that's America. God's delivered her over and over and over. When they were brought low for their iniquity. Nevertheless, he regarded their affliction when he heard their cry. Somebody say, when they repented. He remembered for them his covenant and repented according to the multitude of his mercies. He made them also to be pitied of all those that carried them captives. Verse 47, David cries out and says, save us, O Lord our God, and gather us from among the heathen. Here it is, to give thanks unto thy holy name. And to triumph in thy praise. David cried out and said, God, we have sinned, us and our fathers. We have shed innocent blood as a nation, and because of this, our enemies overtake us. But God, you've been merciful unto us so many a time when we cried out to you in repentance. And God, you repented and you turned from your judgment and you came and defended us and rescued us. And David's crying out again, saying, oh God, we've sinned again. We forgot you like history shows your people has done over and over again, how your nations have turned their back on you. But God, we turn back to you and we cry out to you, forgive us, oh Lord. And he said, save us so we can give you thanks. So we can really give you the sacrifice of thanksgiving. The thanksgiving at the altar. With our hearts pure again. In 1863, our 16th president, Abraham Lincoln, humbly proclaimed a day of thanksgiving unto God Almighty. And that must be noted. It's important. Not just Thanksgiving Day. A day of thanksgiving unto God. The God of the Bible. His son Jesus. Hello? Somebody say it ain't Turkey Day. He noted that it was the Most High God that had blessed America in his mercy, though the nation had sinned. This was on October 3rd, 1863, Abraham Lincoln. 16th president of these United States said these things. So the first Thanksgiving day began not at a table. It began at an altar. Not a table of feasting, but at an altar of fasting and repentance. Where yes, in the midst of their repentance and crying out to God to have mercy on this nation because of sin, they were giving him thanks. Abraham Lincoln said, let's get him thanks because we've deserved his judgment because we have sinned. But let's turn to him, come to the altars on that day, and cry out to him to forgive us of our sins and thank him for his mercy. Because he could have destroyed us, but in his mercy, he's been lenient. Come on, somebody. This was the whole reason. Listen, these are the exact words of President Abraham Lincoln. On October the 3rd, 1863, no human counsel has devised, nor hath any mortal hand worked out these great things. He's talking about how the nation was blessed. No mortal hand has worked these blessings. No human counsel. He said, they are the gracious gifts of the Most High God, who while dealing with us in anger for our sins, has nevertheless remembered mercy. It has seemed to me fit and proper that they should be solemnly, reverently, and gratefully acknowledged as with one heart and one voice by the whole American people. I do therefore invite my fellow citizens in every part of the United States, and also those who are at sea and those who are sojourning in foreign lands, to set apart and to observe the last Thursday of November next. Because remember, it was in October the 3rd of 1863 that he was making this proclamation. So he said, last Thursday of November the next, meaning this coming November, as a day of thanksgiving and praise to our beneficent Father who dwelleth in the heavens. Again, Abraham Lincoln. Imagine that. The President of the United States has mentioned that God has been so merciful to us in spite of our sins. This is why we should be thankful. In his speech, he also recommended, remember, humble penance or repentance for our national perverseness and disobedience. He called Thanksgiving a day of repentance. A time to come to the altar and repent of our perverseness, our perversions, and our disobedience to his word. Wow. God, give us another one like this.
Amen.
Praise God. That's amazing. Somebody shout, these are the words of a president. Sound like a preacher, don't
you? Hallelujah. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Like a prophet. Thanksgiving Day then was a day when the nation repented of their sins and thanked and praised God for his mercy. A modern Thanksgiving Day in America, for the most part, has been irreverently renamed Turkey Day with no mention of sin, repentance, or the mercy of God, or even God himself. You'll see on signs in the merchant store, because the seasons are merchandised. Money making. Today you might walk in Walmart where some church members pay their tithes in. And today you might see 4 days till Thanksgiving. See turkeys everywhere. Butter balls. People dreaming of butter. Thanksgiving ain't a day.
No way.
The Thanksgiving is a life. Oh, thank you, God, for this food we're going to eat. Praise the Lord. Let's get at it. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost?
Jesus.
We just heard you hear it. That it began at an altar, not a table. Stand on your feet with us. Thank you, Holy Ghost. I got my word. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Let us search and try our ways. Let us turn again unto the Lord. Let us lift up our hearts with our hands unto God who dwells in the heavens. Lamentation 3. 41 and 42. Lord, we're not here for a thanksgiving as much as we are for a thanksgiving. For our hands, you want our hearts. Psalms 50 verses 9, you said, I'll take no bullocks from your house. By Psalms 51 again, 16 and 17, you said, the Lord requires no sacrifice or else I'd give it. He delighteth not in burnt offerings. But the sacrifice of God is a broken and contrite spirit, and a broken contrite spirit, O Lord, you will not despise. Lord, you told your people, I don't want your bull no more. I want your hearts broken. I don't want your hands raised and your little lip service, your little kiss like Judas in Luke 22 and 48, betraying Jesus with a kiss, with a little lip service, and your heart be far from me, and your worship become vain because of that. Teaching for doctrines the commandments of me in Matthew 15 and verses 9. Lord God, you don't want our bull thanks. You want our heart. You want our life. And Lord, we've not truly thanked you until like Abraham Lincoln declared on October the 3rd, 1863, that this day of thanks unto God is for his mercy that he has showed us in spite of our national sins. We're a nation that is perverted, we're perverse, and we've disobeyed his written word, which is his will revealed to us as a nation. But in spite of our sins and iniquities, he's had mercy on us. He has showed his grace toward us, and he's blessed us. Therefore, let us take the last Thursday of November, and let us become as one people with one voice, not at a table feasting, but at an altar, fasting, repenting, crying out to God, thanking him for his mercy, being thankful unto him because he has showed us his kindness when we have rebelled against him so long. It was a day he said, let us repent of our sins. Let us rend our hearts. Let us grieve before him with godly sorrow and turn from our iniquities. For in doing so, that's real thanks. Thanks for your mercy. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endureth forever. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for he's the God of gods, and his mercy endureth forever. Be thankful unto the Lord, for he is good. Hallelujah. Who is the Lord of lords, and his mercy endureth forever. Psalms 136, verses 1 through verses 3. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endureth forever. Psalms 118, verse 1 and verse 29. Lord God, as we come before you, as we approach God seasonally, as we come before you even traditionally, Lord God, this time of thanksgiving, help us to understand that thanksgiving was more than a day. Thanksgiving was a life. Lord God, it was being broken before you. Lord God, not filling up at a table, but becoming empty at an altar. Lord God, in repentance, in Holy Spirit, even as David, as we've read today and preached from Psalms 106, how he cried out, save us, in verse 47, save us, O God, from our sins. We have sinned against you. God, save us, so we might bring you thanks. Lord God, we cry out like he did, like Moses. God, forgive us of our sins. Because Psalms 106 and 37 says that the nation in his day, Israel, had sacrificed their sons and daughters unto devils. Lord God, they had shed innocent blood of their sons and daughters and offered them to idols and false gods in the land of Canaan. And because of this, God, you allowed their enemies to dominate them. In America, Lord God, since 1973, forgive us, O Lord, 57 million plus innocent unborn lives, their blood has been shed inside of wombs up until this moment, Lord God. Hallelujah. Lord God, who's the worst terrorist? In the ISIS, Lord, it's politicians, it's the left, it's those that say it's okay to stick that syringe up in the back of that baby's skull as long as his head's still in the womb and suck that baby's brains out. Lord God, all our military might, all our political skill, and all our wealth will not amount to anything against even wimpy enemies when we have sinned and will not repent before you. God, you said when a nation sheds innocent blood, I'll turn that nation over to their enemies. Forgive us, oh God, Have mercy, Lord God, one more time. Because Psalms 106 says often, God, how you turned your people and then they forgot you. Lord God, and how you turned them again and they forgot you. But you said in Psalms 9 in verses 3, that Lord God, you turned man to destruction. And you say unto the children of men, return unto me. You turn nations to destruction. You allow their enemies to destroy them. So that people might cry out back in an altar. Like Nehemiah did in his day in Nehemiah 11 and 17. Lord, they begin the thanksgiving in prayer. Not at a table, but at an altar where their hearts broke. And they said, oh God, like Moses did in Psalms 106, that it was said, and like David did in Psalms 106. Lord, even though they personally may have not sinned the sins that are mentioned, yet they cried out to God in the gap. Saying, Lord, forgive us for our sins and the sins of our fathers. God, may we hear the history. That's his story. Even from our 16th president, Abraham Lincoln, saying the only reason I'm calling for a national day of thanksgiving on the last Thursday of November is so we might fall before God we've rebelled against. God that blessed us and turned from our sins at his altar and thank him for his mercy, because he could have judged us. Holy Ghost, wow. Lord, just show me the Statue of Liberty. I saw her arm with the torch. I saw the light go out and the arm break off. God, I speak your blood over the harbor of New York City. I speak your blood over that city. And I speak your blood over this nation. We have offended you. We've elected leaders in the name of our race, in the name of change, that we knew were for abortion and same-sex marriage. We have offended you. We say we defend life and we must go after the terrorists. But we terrorize our own children in the womb, enslave them by the masses. We have offended you. God, have mercy. Lord, I speak your blood. I see the northern part of California. I see a big wave. I see a tsunami type wave. Whew. I see Hawaii. I see a wave there. I see the Gulf. I see a big wave there. I see the southern part of Mexico. I see a wave that covers it. Holy Ghost. I see fire in Florida. I see a fire. I see smoke rising. How do I look at that? I see the earth open from the midsection of this country, from the Gulf region area, all the way up to the middle of the country, like an earthquake open, all the way up to the northern states. I see in the northeastern part of the country, I see like darkness. I see like a darkness coming. You're going to see false revivals come from there. They won't preach repentance. It'll just all be about feeling good and emotion and hyper and testimonies of miracles, but no preaching. No message of the cross, no blood. To revival without repentance. I see darkness. Holy Ghost. I have never in 25 plus years saw what I just see. Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. I see an authentic move coming out of somewhere in Alabama. I see it starting to spread. It'll come like east, then a little zigzag. I see God doing something mighty in northern part of Georgia and up through Tennessee. Thank you, Holy Ghost. It's like I can see states, Carolinas. It's like they light up. They'll blink. I'm literally seeing this while I'm telling you. Like I blink, and God said that'll be my touch as I move. It'll be quick moves. It won't be with one man's name on it. God said be warned about revivals that have one man or one church. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Lord, I again speak your blood over New York. Or speak your blood. Speak your blood over Washington. I see like armies around Washington. Not Washington State, but Washington, D.C. Praise God. Wow. Now it's just like I'm having pictures and glimpses of graveyards and graves open. Praise God. And I hear the voice of God, then shall I come. Hey.
Hallelujah.
I will come, saith the Lord. I will increase my word, and it will be magnified and glorified. It will be multiplied. It will prevail even in the midst of all the persecution. Much persecution shall rise against those that are chosen. And those that are anointed. Evil men shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Those that live godly in me and my son Christ will suffer persecution. But as I did in the book of Acts, when my people, my chosen, were persecuted, the more they were attacked, even as I said in Exodus 1 and 12, or 7, with my people, Israel, my Hebrew children, the more they were afflicted, the more they grew and multiplied. My word shall grow, it shall multiply, but my power shall increase with signs and wonders in these last hours, but it shall come riding on the wings of persecution. Gross darkness will cover this earth, but you will hear me saying, arise. For thy light has come. Whew. And my glory shall arise upon you. Be warned, saith the Lord, of these false teachers who preach about my glory but never mention my cross or blood. Be warned, for they're many, and you shall see many more of them, saith the Lord. They will become so popular, their followers shall gather many. Even some that are elect shall be deceived by them because of that manifests around them. They will preach a message of glory, but it's vain. For it has no mentioning of my blood or cross. It is void of repentance. Be careful, saith my son Abosha. Be careful, saith the Lord to my little ones. Hallelujah.
Gatoloria sa,
Yay! Before you let me Kasaya.
For I'm not through with this nation. I'm not through moving. I'm not through doing and being who I am. For I am that I am. I am that I am is exalted above Isis, who is that it is. For behold, I am greater. And behold, you shall see my hand. For I have heard the sounds of repentance. Though it's been few, I have heard, even like Abraham asked me in the days of Lot in Sodom and Gomorrah, Lord, if there are only 10, would you spare? And I said, I will. But I've heard more than 10, and I still have a remnant. And as long as I still have a remnant that is repentant before me and that follows me, following me with all their heart, I, the Lord, will send my spirit and I will use him to reap in these last days by the sickle of my strength. A harvest shall come. And I say to you, don't be distracted by the events that you see on the screen of your TV and your phones and your computers. Neither saith the Lord, let the headlines deter thee. Let thy mind be focused on me, for there shall be wars and rumors of wars. Things shall come on this earth. Have not I told you beforehand? The waves and the seas will roar. Men's hearts will be perplexed and filled with fear as they look after those things and come upon the earth. Did not I say then, when you see these things come to pass, look up, lift up your head. Your redemption draweth nigh. For behold, this earth you will inherit it. If you're meek before me, I, the Lord, Lord, will give you this earth in my return in the days ahead. You are victors in me, for I, the Lord, will come again, and all my enemies shall bow, and I shall defeat the enemies of Israel, my people. And behold, I shall reward the faithful.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. So steady your faith. Remain focused on me. Be not deceived. For behold, I come quickly, saith the Lord. Holy God. Let's play that last song I gave you. This will be one message you'll probably want to get. Whether you get it on DVD or CD. Holy Ghost. Thanksgiving altar. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Remember, it started at the altar, not the table. The last song I gave you. Hunger for 6:1. That's how David started off. Before he concluded in verse 47, save us, O Lord our God, and gather us from among the heathens, so we might give thanks unto you and triumph in the praise of your name. It's a thanksgiving of mercy for the mercy of God. In spite of our national sins, God, you've showed us mercy. Save us, O God, we turn back to you. Son of Man comes, Matthew 24, verse 44. Repent and be ye converted. You can't be converted until you're willing to repent. Repentance don't mean just turn from your sin. It means to turn to God. You can stop doing wrong and become morally good. The hell's full of morally good people. You got to turn to the Master. Turn to His cross and His shed blood. And be born again. again, John 3:3, for except a man be born again, he not enter the kingdom of heaven. Come on, my spirit will not always plead with me at Genesis 6:3. The Holy Ghost is dealing with your heart. You better come while you can. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will hear my voice and open the door, I'll come into him and sup with him and he with me. Revelation 3:20. Don't you hear his voice knocking? Remember, God don't want you boom. He don't want your church attendance without your heart. That's boom. He don't receive that sacrifice. Along with the sacrifice of thanksgiving and calling your name, Psalms 116:17. That sacrifice of thanksgiving is like Jonah in the belly of the whale, in the depths of the ocean, in rebellion. He repents of his rebellion. He's running from God. In Jonah 2:9, he said, I will call upon God and offer the sacrifice of thanksgiving. That means repentance. The sacrifice of thanksgiving is a repentant heart, a broken heart. He said, oh God, I'll repent. And he called that place salvation, for salvation is of the Lord. And in verse 10, God spake to the fish, and it vomited him out on the dry land. Oh God, when a nation cries out to you with a sacrifice of thanksgiving, which is a sound of repentance, God, we've sinned, we've turned from you, and God, we're calling out to you, have mercy on us. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Save us, oh God. Lord God, you'll speak to the things that swallow us. Lord God, and it'll eject us into the wheel, in the place of God. Lord, he went to Nineveh, and Nineveh repented. Hallelujah. Holy Ghost. He called his salvation experience the sacrifice of thanksgiving. Lord, what big fishes have you prepared for America? Saints, cry out to him. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on us. Cried as Bartimaeus did in Mark 10. Son of David, have mercy on us. Open our blinded eyes. For our leaders are blind guides, and they lead the blind, and everyone's fallen in a ditch. Lord God, have mercy on us. Open our eyes. Hey, hallelujah. Open our eyes. Before it's too late. Come on, saints, pray. Somebody in this room, the Holy Ghost is dealing with you. Your heart feel like it's about to beat out your chest. That's the Holy Ghost constraining you with his love. God said, my spirit is what quickens. The flesh profits nothing, John 6:63. It's the Holy Ghost that draws. It's the Spirit of God that bears witness by our spirit, with our spirit, with the children of God, Romans 8:16. We're children of God through faith in Jesus, Galatians 3:26. We might be all the creation of God, but we're not all children of God. You're not a child of God until you got faith in Christ who hung on this cross. And you turn from your sins, calling out to him in repentance for forgiveness. Come on. There's somebody in here, you're his creation, but you're not his child. It's time to take this Jesus. Because you're going to stand before God the Father in eternity one day, every one of us will. And the first thing he's going to judge concerning you is what you did with his son and his shed blood on that cross. Come on. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission, Romans 9:22. There's no forgiveness, no deliverance without the shedding of his blood. Come on, cry out to him. Come to him while you can. Don't put him off, put him on. You can come and call on him. John 6:37, he said, I'll in no wise turn you away if you'll call on me. He won't turn you down if you won't turn him down. You'll come. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, Romans 10:13. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be delivered, Joel chapter 2, verse 32. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Romans 10, 9. So come! Today is the day of salvation, 2 Corinthians 6, 2. Wherefore today, if you'll hear the voice of the Holy Ghost, Hebrews 3, 7. Any voice and any preacher that tells you tomorrow is a lying spirit, a soothsaying spirit, to soothe your soul right to hell. Hear the voice of the Holy Ghost. Now's the time. Boast not yourself in tomorrow. You do not know what a day will bring, Proverbs 27 and 1. Now or never. Now's the time. Come on, saints, pray right here. A wise man wins souls, Proverbs 11 and 30. I'll leave the 99 to go after one, and I'll leave that one turkey to go after 99. I care less about what's on the table out here. I'm more concerned about what's at the altar and who's at the altar. Come. This song's about to end like it's ended for the last four times. When it ends this time, I'm through. One day, like this song, your life's going to end. Jewish measurement, Psalms 39 and 5, calls a handbreadth. It's about 3 inches in the space of the palm of the hand. David said, my life's like a handbreadth, meaning my life's so short. Friend, eternity is forever. Life here is just a moment, just a shit. On everyone's headstone in a graveyard, you'll see a birth date, you'll see a death date, and that little 3-inch dash between both. That little 3-inch dash is your life. That's my life. Your birth date's already inscribed. You don't know when your death date is. But if Jesus tarries, it's a sure thing. Don't waste your dash. Do not waste your dash. Your dash could be at its end. Your death date could be inscribed hours from now, a day from now, 3 days from now. Better come while you can. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. What Jehoshaphat's army saying in 2 Chronicles 20. His mercy endureth forever. I gave him thanks for his mercy that lasts forever. The enemies were slain on the battlefield. Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord. We don't deserve it. We give you thanks. Really, that's all we have to offer. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, thank you. Thank you for your amazing grace. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. Yes, we do. Turn us, O God, and we'll be turned. Renew our days as of old. Limitation 5:21. Holy, holy. You are holy. You are holy. Yes, you are. Holy. That little sailor, that little pause in the song is about the length of your life before God. Better not waste it. Jonah 3:1, after Jonah got spit out on that land, said the word of the Lord came to him a second time. Let that song play one more time, Brother Paul. I know I said I was going to stop it. Hallelujah. But God said second chance. You know, God's not a God of third chances, fourth chances, fifth chances, and seventh. When it comes to chances, God gives two. And what I mean by that is once you get the second call, every call after that's a second chance. It's not a bunch of chances. You still got grace on that second chance. Don't you know hell's full of people who said, man, I listen on that second chance. That long time, that long second call. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Safe for you to do so. Put your hazard lights on if you're listening to this on the audio. Pull up the side of the road. Make sure you're safe distance off the road. Nothing around you. Put that car in park. Use your steering wheels in order. Cry out to God. You better never make it to your destination. You better give your life to Him now. If you're watching on video, you're watching over the internet. Maybe your last chance of many second chances. Just make your iPhone an altar right now. Make that laptop in front of you or that TV that you're watching this on social media through. You better make the place before it an altar and call out to it. For the Lord is ready to forgive all those that have called upon Him and have mercy on them. Psalms 86, 5. Thank you, Lord, you're more ready to forgive us than we are to receive. Holy, 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 worthy, Jesus, Jesus. Preacher, I only got one life to live, that's a lie. You die here, you live forever, either in heaven or hell. You got two lives to live. Where are you going to live when you leave this life? Surely there's an end. Proverbs 23:18. That word end in Hebrew means a hereafter. There's once upon it and a man to die. And after that's the judgment. Hebrews 9:27. Yeah, our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing grace. Yes, you do. Our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. God, I bear record this day, my hands are pure from the blood of all men. In Jesus' name. Come on, brother. Hallelujah. I would say forgive me for not operating in the gifts, but according to Hebrews 2,